This is a public service video made to help people who are looking to rent in Montreal. Renting in Montreal is pretty complex, so it's going to be a three-part video. This video is going to deal with the starting off and finding your lease. The second video is going to talk about life with a lease, and the third video is about finishing off and ending your lease. I'll put all the resources that I'm talking about in the comments. If you know something that I've missed, you should add it. If it flies, I'll put it into the comments as well. So the first thing you want to do is find a place. The way that I did this when I first moved to Montreal was through Craigslist. Craigslist doesn't seem to be a thing anymore, so don't worry about that, even if it's common in the place you were before. The most popular standard forum now seems to be Kijiji. Several landlords I know have only posted on that. Kijiji has these tools that let you save searches. So you can save a search with things that you like. I personally found it kind of useful because I like hippies to look for things like compost and vegan. That's often how people are going to say that it's close to public transit or maybe the neighborhood that you're interested in renting in. If you're not looking on Kijiji and you want another website, the one that I use is called WalkScore. So it's most well known for scoring how easy it is to get to and from something, but it also has a pretty good search system which lets you see on a map how far it is from the place that you're looking at living to the place that you're commuting to each day, amongst other things. So I'd say it's probably the best and most useful aggregator because it grabs the Kijiji listings already and any listings from other websites that it can scrape, and it adds this kind of useful tool set on top. You can tell that I used WalkScore because my current place is 2 minutes from a metro. When you're looking at a place in summer, that doesn't make sense, but when winter hits, you're going to appreciate being relatively close to a metro or a transit line. A new arrival that's showing up in Canada as of 2018, I believe, is Facebook Marketplace. The UI is pretty good. It lets you place things on a map, and it seems quite popular. However, after talking to my landlord, a lot of them aren't presently using it. From what I've seen at this point in time, it's most popular for roommate and room rentals. Keep an eye on that. It's definitely an up-and-comer. So lease transfers are a system that was put in place by the government to allow tenants to get out of their lease. What lease transfers have turned into is a kind of grey market where people who are sitting on a lease that's now substantially lower than the market rate are able to sell or trade their lease to a new person. Subsequently, there are a lot of markets for these where people who are looking to change their living arrangements will often advertise their lease. You'll often see people looking for a swap. They'll be saying something like, I got married and I have a kid, I need a bigger place, so I'm willing to swap my smaller place for a bigger place. A trick that I would suggest is scope out places where you might want to live and friends who have leases in those sorts of places. And then if you ever hear word of someone who wants to move, go up to them and say, hey, I'd really like your place. You know, like it's the neighborhood that I've been looking to move into, and I'd be prepared to pay your moving expenses. It's worth it because a lease pretty quickly, especially if it's an older one, rapidly adds up to being a lot more than most chunks of change that people would lay down. And it lets the person know that you're serious, and it gives them a bit of an excuse. Oh, it's just moving expenses. It's not that I'm participating in this grey market or showing favouritism to this person. There are a couple of Facebook groups for the lease transfers. I'd recommend following them. If you don't have time, though, it's pretty hard to get a lease transfer. They're a lot more tricky. They are totally worth it, though, and I seriously would recommend being prepared to lay some cash down to make sure it happens for you. There's another thing you'll often see in Montreal, which is something I've never seen anywhere else, and that is the number and half based system for the size of a place. It is awful. It's a terrible, terrible system. It's basically a room count where halves are a bathroom and the holes are potential bedrooms or rooms. Generally though, you're going to want to read the listing to see exactly what's in there. I mean, obviously every house has a bathroom, obviously every house has rooms, and obviously it's open to interpretation whether that's a living room or it's a bedroom. It's a pretty useless system that's seen as an acceptable way for some reason to tell people quickly what something is. But really all it tells you is it's a reasonable sized property. If it's, you know, if it was 8.5, it's huge. It will work at very, very small sizes. A 1.5, it could only be one thing, a bedroom and a bathroom.
Not this time. It's totally made up. We made it up. We made this one up.
Whereas a 2.5, whoa, you know, what is that? It immediately becomes kind of useless. you found your place, I'm sure you know how to send a message to the person on whatever platform, and you're going along to have a look. A lot of the time, the landlords, at least in Montreal in the past, haven't made a bunch of money, so they want to get someone who's just going to make it easy for them. Wear reasonable clothes and be prepared. Have cash in your pocket if you really want the place. Be prepared to sign. And you can also provide a letter of recommendation. Generally, if you look organized and serious, like everything in life, the person on the other side is going to take you seriously. Don't appear like you're high on Adderall, though, and going like, yeah, I want this place. Sure. Just say something along the lines of like, I've looked at quite a few places. This place seems really nice. You know, I think I'm prepared to commit. What do we do now? Something like that. References as a thing are totally normal for a landlord to ask for. It's pretty typical for them to ask for your previous two landlords. As far as proving that you're employed, you actually don't have to provide anything. They are allowed to ask though. And with a lot of these things, especially in the early stages, you can kind of just play out the situation in your head, right? The landlord could say, could I get a proof of employment from you or a letter from your employer? And you can say like, it's not within your right to ask me for that. I will not provide you with the proof of employment. And then what do you think the landlord's gonna do? You know, they will go with the person who gives them it. You can give them a kind of censored document, potentially from your HR department. So you could say to them, don't tell them what my salary is, but tell them how long I've been employed and that there's no risk of my job going away or something like that. The other thing to keep in mind is identification. Don't give them your SIN number. Don't give them anything that you'd be worried about identity theft as a result of. They have no right to copy your documents or take them away with them. They're able to request a credit score for you, and they do need those documents, at least to cite those documents in order to get that process underway. Now, if you're in a group of people who are watching this video as a new arrival to Montreal, the references thing doesn't always work. It certainly didn't for me. J'ai vu trois lignes croissants, juste enchanté. Où est la bibliothèque? Voilà mon passeport. When I came here, I had the landlord go, well, I don't know any of these references you have. The reason that they want a landlord who's from town is because the landlords of town have this secret club that they're a part of, which I will, wait a sec, I actually have a copy of their magazine. This is their secret club magazine. So the landlords in town are a member of this organization, and this organization has a database which they can look up your name in. If you didn't pay rent or you trashed some property in your past, your name's going to be in their database. Now, if you didn't rent in Quebec, it's understandable that they're going to feel like they don't have as much information and they can't quickly validate that you're cool. Subsequently, they'll do what is super normal in every other place I've ever lived and ask for a damage deposit or a month in advance. Interestingly enough, they're actually not allowed to do this. It's explicitly forbidden, which is why you'll often get this kind of weird, cagey, hey, so your previous landlord isn't in Quebec, couldn't get a hold of them. Do you mind maybe paying a damage deposit? That's them being a little uncomfortable with the fact that they're breaking the law at that moment. Now, you can say no. You can say, oh, I'm outraged. The police aren't going to come and arrest them or anything. I've never heard of a case of this. But what they're going to do if you say, well, no, is, again, much like the employer thing, be like, oh, okay, well, we'll keep you in mind, and then you'll never hear from them again. I would compare this to drinking a beer in the park, which is against the law, but it's so normal that it shouldn't really freak you out. I would just make sure that you get something in writing so that you can get that money back at the end, like you would anywhere. So we're assuming that you've met the landlord, they like you, they checked your references and your credit score and everything looks good. They'll probably then want to sit you down and fill in the lease. This is what you'll usually get. So this is the lease agreement from the first place I rented in Montreal, and it's still exactly the same. The Régie de Logement give this out to landlords. They can buy it for like a buck or whatever. So it's three panels like this, along with a bunch of legislation on the back. It's kind of a well-crafted document that I think they've figured out over the years. The landlords since 1996 have been required to fill one of these in. The reason for this is because there's a few sections in here that you would not want to put into an agreement if you're a landlord, namely section G, which says to the new lessee what the property was leased for before. So they have to write in here, because it's section 1896 of the Quebec Civil Code, we're leasing it last year for $2,000. And that means that you're aware of the fact that there's been a rent increase, which you can argue about after you've gotten your lease. So you want to make sure that this is the form that you're filling in. Another thing that's really good about this form is the standard boilerplate of it is really reasonable. So you're filling it in, you can just look for the stuff that's been handwritten and effectively check if you're okay with that. So any conditions or anything that's non-standard is going to be written in, and you can read it and decide, are you okay with no pets, no smoking, you know, no air conditioner, no flying flags. That's actually a condition of my current lease for some reason. One other thing that can happen on the side of a lease agreement is this cashback thing. Because of the way rent control works, it generally means that prices increase at a much slower rate than the actual market rate increases at. And so a lot of landlords will do this thing where you sign the lease agreement at a certain price, and then they sign a side contract with you to give you a cashback over a period of time. Don't be freaked out. It is actually something that's fairly normal. It's just another way that landlords are generally skirting around the law. So insurance on the building is not required. Your landlord, if they've paid off their mortgage, may not have any. However, you may want to consider getting it. The reason for this, besides stolen property and the usual stuff, is if you were the cause of damage to your property and the damage was substantial, the landlord's insurer may go after you and sue you to try to recover costs. You lit a candle and you left it unattended. It burnt down 20 units. You're now bankrupt. If you're risk adverse and you like getting insurance, that might be something you want to do. If you're not risk adverse like me, who needs insurance? Moving day in Quebec is actually an artifact of the government requiring that leases started and ended on the same date historically. Interestingly enough, New York used to have the same agreement. I found this really hilarious painting by an artist in New York of what moving day looks like. About 100,000 people in Montreal move on that day, which is absolutely insane. It's terrible because it creates a huge peak in demand on this one particular day of the year where everyone needs to get the moving trucks and everyone needs to get the moving trailers. So what I'd suggest doing is booking at least 6 months in advance any moving equipment that you might need, or making sure you have a friend living in Ontario or some normal place, which is the rest of the world, to borrow their car or whatever it is that you're going to need, because you're not going to be able to get it in Montreal. One of the other things that's kind of bad about moving day is that usually you're moving into a place that the other person is moving out of at exactly the same time. So you'll often have this thing where you're moving all your boxes into the left room and they're taking them out of the right room, which is why I don't think an oven has ever been cleaned on moving day in Montreal's history. You end up often spending the first week or two cleaning up after the previous tenant who's not had enough time to move their stuff out and actually do a proper job even if they wanted to. The last thing that's terrible about moving day is that it's so often incredibly hot on that day. If you're not in the process of moving that weekend, I find it's really fun to walk around town and see all those people just dragging a couch up three flights of stairs or whatever, and have that moment of blissful appreciation of your life and how lucky you are to not be one of those poor fucking bastards out there sweating their balls off moving all this shit up and down these ancient staircases. There is one benefit to moving in Quebec, and that's that we don't really have fuel oil as a thing here. So when you move into your new place, Hydro-Quebec, and you're sorted. Most people will then want an internet connection. I had to get one from scratch, so like I was moving into a house that didn't actually have one in the first place, and it took 2 weeks, but I think a lot of people can get it transferred over almost immediately. It's just a flick of a switch. And now you've moved into your place, you're having your pizza, you're rewarding your friends. If you happen to have been moving into the property at the same time as someone else was leaving, ask them what they paid in rent. You want to check with them that basically your landlord didn't lie on the agreement that you had. I know a few people who have busted their landlord for bumping up their rent without doing any substantial improvements on the building. Tenants will put their previous year's lease into the drawer somewhere in the house, which only you will find when you're moving in. So keep an eye out for it. You can at least with this information decide whether you want to fight the landlord and get your rent reduced back to a level that makes sense, one that's in line with the general year-on-year appreciation, or not. You may decide it's not worth of a hassle. It seldom is if you've got better shit to do. At least you know that something like that has occurred. And it probably tells you a little bit about what your future relationship with a landlord is going to be like, which is what I'll be dealing with in the next video. See you then.